After watching this episode 3 times, I'm still as confused as how to feel as when I watched it the first time. And understandably so to some degree. Throughout this review, you're going to be understanding my praises and my dislikes. So if you like these reviews as per usual, click the like and subscribe. And of course, watch the video as planned. And yeah, let's get on to it, shall we? And we'll try our best to deep dive into as much as we possibly can. When it comes to live reactions, it was definitely one of my weakest live reactions, and when I look at the episode again and again, as I said, watching it 3 times, I understood why. It is what you would expect from an exposition episode, where there's a lot of talking, a lot of dialogue, a lot of tone down, to which we discussed not only in the live reaction but also in the spoilers video as well, where we kind of discussed that, yes, you're not going to get high action, and from what I wanted throughout this episode was at least a bit of character acting in comparison to what we've been getting in the previous episodes. Though, how I know how the production of Bleach has been going for the ambitions that Taguchi is going for, I may understand that this episode maybe was used as a bit of a non-priority episode to work on throughout this season. And understandably so, I think they did a great job throughout the look of things in general. Sure, there was a few character models here and there that didn't quite look up to how I imagined, and there was some, you know, little bits of blips here and there in terms of characters' faces, but these are things that of course can be fixed later on in the Blu-ray. There was scenes, for example, with Soifon, which I thought, you know, lacked a little bit in terms of, like, I guess, severity, if that makes sense. One of those being Komamura shouting at Soifon. There was not really a full face shot given that kind of scary look to Komamura, and also when Tanjiro, and we'll talk about the flash step in a minute, flash steps behind her and her face kind of looking a bit derpy, to say the least. In the manga, it's more so of a serious yet confused face of what's just happened and kind of processing what has just happened. So I didn't really get that from this episode, and it's things like that that, you know, I can kind of look the other way. These are things that can be corrected, and I'm not going to really hold too much issue towards it as a whole. This episode did have some good reveals in terms of Squad Zero, and of course the post ending credit scene with, you know, the Soul King towards the end, which was really nice. Still confusing, but nice overall. And we get a little bit of a glimpse of what some of the Squad Zero members can do and what they're prioritizing, and a little bit of the world building aspect of Bleach, which can be a little bit boring after you've just come up from some massive high highs. I think, again, this episode did well, considering it covered about 5 chapters. So imagine reading this over the course of 5 weeks. I think we got the better deal in regards to that, even though I was there for those 5 weeks. Nonetheless, the pacing for the anime is making it better than waiting those 5 weeks, is my point. Truthfully speaking, it is probably one of the weakest episodes. And when I say that, I don't mean that in a bad way at all, because again, considering the context and the material that this series had to work with in regarding to this specific episode, I feel next episode will be a lot more stronger in terms of understanding what Tanjiro can do, or something like what Kirino can do, and kind of getting onto the point a little bit, especially with potential other characters that are going to come into the mix towards maybe the end of the episode. That would be really cool, and I think it will be. So it is a bit of a weird transition, this episode. It is a transitional episode of where it doesn't really have anything shining for it. And again, yes, the Soul King was a shining thing, but does that 1 second to 2 seconds really make up for the majority of the episode? Probably not. But if you are someone that's invested in Bleach and you're interested in the lore and the world building of Bleach, you are absolutely going to love this episode. So from an episode perspective, or from the casual viewer's perspective, are they going to enjoy this episode? I think this episode would be enjoyable if it was through binge watching rather than a weekly watch through. That again, I make it seem like it's bad, but in realistic terms, it's not, because again, from the content that it did, it was good. Let's talk about things that I liked. I really enjoyed the fact that, you know, it was 5 chapters instead of 4. However, I do feel they could have stayed with the 4 and still got some of the job done. However, I love the setting towards the first half of the episode. Using the lighting, Taguchi lighting is always good as per usual. Using the lanterns, showing power outages, showing the rubble, showing Squad 4 going out there onto the front lines, trying to see what Soul Reapers are alive, and Kyoraku seeing the big hole that is in the ground where Yamamoto, I guess, now lies, if he hasn't already been disintegrated, which is probably the case. For all my Hell Arc knowers, that's going to be really difficult to have the funeral for. Probably mess something up along the process, but, you know, we won't talk about that. I do feel like the captain's meeting, where they were talking about Genryu Sai Yamamoto, was a bit lacking in terms of the emotion, but again, it still set the tone in terms of setting, in terms of lighting. And I have to give props to Kyoraku, because he is the one kind of taking the mantle here and kind of keeping everyone in check. He is, in fact, one of the oldest, along with Uketake, and Unohana's too busy in Squad 4 Division Barracks healing people, so Kyoraku is doing his damn best in proving why he is the most maturest and the most experienced into the Gotei 13, so to say. I will have to say as well, just like I did in my live reaction, that it seems that I was wrong in the fact of talking about Ichigo's flash step in episode 7. It does now sound like more of a sonido, because we get to hear the flash step of what that sounds like now, and it has more of like a lightning undertone to it, which was really nice. Whether that was specific to Kurinji, that's also a plausibility, but the sounds are just too vast to probably be the case. So yes, it seems that Ichigo was using sonido, and maybe that's very important for the future. Who knows? You'll have to watch and wait and see. But if you're here to watch this review, chances are you are here to hear me talk about the quote-unquote censorship slash removal of some certain scenes. So let's get into them, shall we? And I think we should just start off right off the bat with what everyone was thinking when they saw this episode. Rukia's peach. If you don't know what that means Rukia's ass floating in the hot springs. You know, when I look at this episode and I see what comedy got taken out in terms of like maybe some of the banter with Rukia, or maybe some things such as like Kon and pressing his eyeballs to turn off the projection from Urahara. Again, after watching it 3 times, I'm kind of understanding why they made certain choices the way they did in terms of removing some certain gag moments. Now, I do feel coming into the Thousand Year Blue Arc, it has become more serious. It has a more serious undertone. I think we can all agree that this is the direction that Taguchi and even Kubo want to go with this. Again, with manga, you need to add a lot of filler panels to kind of make that 20-page deadline. And it was probably these gag pages, and again, we're making shonen manga for the demographic of boys and young teenagers. And considering that the Thousand Year Blue Arc was considered not even to be made for a TV animation in Kubo's mind, this is his true vision. You know, we're taking out all the fluff, all the gags, and we're making this a serious arc. And considering that this is a midnight time slot on TV, this clearly is for a young adult audience. So it's going to have a more young adult audience mind. With that being said, more young adult audiences are probably going to like the more sexual innuendos. In this case, was Rukia's ass a bit of a sexual innuendo? I guess it was more of a funny thing than a sexualized thing. Even though the majority of us are horny as fuck. Speak for yourself, James. Yes, fine, okay. But still, was it needed? In fact, a lot of that scene in the hot springs was cut out in general. In fact, I could even cope and argue that next episode will probably show more, potentially because we're not out the hot spring scene yet. And by the way that this episode ended was, again, just like in my live reaction, I was very surprised that they showcased Kurinji's name and then just cut to the ending. It just seemed very abrupt and very just not directed properly in that regard, or storyboarded. I'm not quite sure, it just didn't feel right. It seemed just out the blue. And to be honest, so did the hot spring scenes. I mean, to even the things about the towel being on Ichigo's head, that if he removed it, or the reactor would go up to his head and kind of leak out and kill him, supposedly, from Kurinji. Are these things just not applicable anymore? Again, I do think that many of these things are fluff. It was, you know, Kurinji and Ichigo arguing back and forth for maybe longer than it should, understandably so. If this is a weekly basis, you know, you want to try and get as much as you can. But from an episode perspective, maybe that's all it needed to do to get to the point. However, it did feel a little bit forced. However, I say that and I debate with myself that there could be more next episode about the hot springs. Well, in fact, there will be, because I've read the next few chapters, so yes. So, I mean, look, we can still get it. However, is it really necessary? We see them in the hot springs, but hey, if you want it, it's in the manga, ready to go. Another thing that people are going to complain about, if you don't mention it, you know, people are going to be in the comments about it, talking about Ikaku and Renji's Bankai. More specifically, when Mayuri mentions talking about it, talking about how a damaged Bankai cannot be repaired, and that, have you noticed that Zabimaru has chips or damage to it in comparison to when he fought with Byakuya? But when Ikaku is only using a fraction of his Bankai, because, what's his name, Enrad kind of just destroyed destroyed it. These things I can kind of let pass by, and the reason for it is because, you know, as a manga reader, I know where these things can place, so I'm not going to complain right off the bat. A lot of us was doing a bit of complaining when it came towards Chojuro and having like his funeral thing, even though realistically it's not that big of a deal because nobody really cared about Chojuro. In fact, people care about Chojuro now more than ever, which is surprising. And you know, the anime has done such a good job in adding in content where it needs to be. I don't think there's been a point in the anime so far in terms of information where we've kind of tilted our head and been like, that's a bad choice, because it's kind of in some way, shape, form or another, it's been brought into a different conversation or brought into relevancy later on, or it just wasn't relevant full stop. So when it comes to talk about Bankai, maybe not so much more Ikkaku, but especially towards Renji's case, right? Is it relevant that his Bankai is broken? Well, considering, you know, that we're going to have conversations with Namaya and we're going to be having conversations with Ichibei, I think those things can be slightly added in or be even better. To some extent, it might even be irrelevant. And to some extent, Mayuri might even know, in terms of Renji's case anyway, that it is what it is. Try not to spoil. So again, my manga readers, you know about it. In terms of Ikkaku's case, I don't know. As long as Renji's case gets brought up a little bit, I think that that justifies it. I don't think Ikkaku kind of relevant in that regard. And the only reason why I say that after looking back on the manga is that it was said that Akon had repaired it to some certain degree, or made it look like as if it was repaired. Akon, of all people, but not Mayuri. That being said, it was told to be kept a secret. So in this regard, only Ikkaku and Yumichika, I believe, and Akon and Mayuri are supposed to know about this Bankai. Again, I think it's interesting information to throw in there in terms of like a manga perspective. However, was Mayuri maybe the right person to say it? Would Ikkaku in the first place even mention it to Akon or Mayuri? Would he be prideful enough to not tell them? It seems a bit weird on Ikkaku's character to go and do that. However, as I said, I think it can be replaced. I did enjoy the Squad Zero lookout. I enjoyed the fact that, like, in comparison to the manga, we get to see all the little plates of where all the captains live. And it was really interesting to look at these specific plates and try and guess where every single captain lives in the Squad Zero. I think I've probably got 3 out of the 5 correct, but who knows. And it was also nice to have a little bit of a close-up shot of Kurinji's place as well. I guess one of the things about the Soul King that I said I wasn't really too confident in regards is that, like, the way that Ichibei talks about, oh, how the Soul King is alive, or he is awakened and he can understand him. It's always been a bit of a mystery, the Soul King has. You know, sure, we have the light novels which go a little bit deeper into things, but I really hope that they really push for understanding about the Soul King, because it gets to a point where I've read this series so many times and I don't truly understand in this arc what the Soul King does, or his consciousness, even about his limbs to some certain degree. Of course, there's discussion about, you know, Panida and Gerard and Ukitake and X, Y, and Z, right? Again, those are so vague comments, you won't really understand it. The point I'm trying to make is, it's still very, like, up in the air and still very confusing to some degree, that even on Club Kubo, people are asking Kubo questions in his exclusive fan club, and even he doesn't really explain things. And the reason why I believe he's not explaining things as well is because I feel like he's going to be adding this additional content into the anime, so I'm kind of on hopium in that regard. But yeah, for the longest time, I've always wanted to do a history of Bleach, talking about the timelines from the very start of Bleach all the way to the very end, and I'm talking from a lore perspective, and it still kind of throws me off to some degree in terms of, like, yeah, sure, I understand Hikifune or Kiriko, as you would know her by now, the one that slaps Shinji. Obviously Shinji and Hyori know her. We know her from the Turn Back the Pendulum Mark from 110 years ago, and we know that she was recently recruited to the Soul Palace from Turn Back the Pendulum. However, then on the other side of the coin, you have Senjimaru, which seems to know Mayuri. She seems to have known about the research and development as she was once there, as it is presumably said within this episode and in the manga that security is lax since I've been there. You know, she clearly is of somewhat a scientist to some degree, is what we can imagine from this episode and from the chapter. However, again, for the manga heads out there, the Shihak shows that were made 1,000 years ago, was Mayuri there? Did he exist? Well, surely he did, right? Or was Senjimaru even a captain at that point? What exactly was she? When did she go to the Soul Palace? When? What was her contribution in terms of the research and development department? You know, what was her relevance towards maybe Kisuke or even Mayuri today at that example? And I feel like there's a bit of lost time in there. We just don't really know. And it does bug me a little bit because until I find that out, it's really going to sit like really rent free in my head. I do feel like there was a bit of misadded dialogue in regards to Kurenji and Unohana. I felt like they could have had a bit more of a back and forth. Though I'm glad that they added in the scene with Kyoraku looking at Unohana and Kurenji's kind of interaction. It was kind of spotlighted within the manga, but in this one it was kind of blurred out and then focused in when Kyoraku was being mentioned. It can be extremely easy to miss if you are an anime only watcher. And I guess truly to round it all up, because I don't want to seem disinterested in this review because I'm still very confused on how to feel about it. I do feel like it was a weak episode. Again, but it's not bad. It just is a weak episode out of all of them. But it's understandable, right? I think in conclusion, this episode is generally an unpolished episode. I feel like a lot more can be done in terms of, you know, character acting, fluidity in terms of character movements, you know, cleaned up character faces. Again, the settings are fine and the content itself is fine. I do feel like some things maybe shouldn't have been cut, but I'm going to give it leeway for future episodes. I feel like I'm kind of forcing myself to do this review because I don't truly know how to feel about it. And I don't think really anyone really cares. I think everyone kind of just enjoys it for what it is. And it's not groundbreaking by any stretch of the imagination. I think the only kind of thing that really pushes this episode, in fact, was a little bit of the controversy in regards to some of the panels being removed, which is honestly an awful shame because I do want people to discuss about the Soul King and I do want people to discuss about the Soul Palace a little bit. But in that regards, I will leave it off on one thing too, because in the manga as well, it shows a bit of like a nobody henchman or a nobody kind of soldier, I guess you could say, kind of talking to the Soul King saying, "Oh, you've awakened your majesty." But in the anime, it's more so Ichibe. I wonder, because they are, well, they don't really have squads per se, they don't really have men per se. To some extent, I am really interested to see how that world works. You know, you have all these buildings, but no civilians. But then at the same time, you have like these men going around that are apparently watching over the Soul King. And further on in the manga, Yuha leaves a trail of bodies. And it makes me wonder, I thought, you know, the five captains were the only ones there. So I wonder, again, what's going to get changed. I'm going to leave it with that. It's nothing too special of an episode, but it's pretty average. I think it was okay and good. So I'm going to give it a 7 out of 10, maybe a 6 out of 10. Thought it was all right. I forgot as well. How could I forget? Kukaku Shiba. Just want to mention, that was a beautiful shot of Kukaku Shiba. And of course, Ishin as well. That was really nice. And that was new. Also, Kukaku has no arm now. She doesn't have the wooden arm that, you know, was in the previous anime, which is good because that is her true form, so to say. So that was really nice. And again, to see the Fullbringers. Many people actually are surprised by the Fullbringers because, oh, well, didn't Ginjo die in like the Fullbringer arc? Yes, he did die. And what happens when you die? You go to heaven. And what is heaven in Bleach? It's the Soul Society. So, yes, Ginjo's dead. He is a soul in the Soul Society. Might not be a Soul Reaper, we don't know. But, you know, he hasn't gone to the academy and trained up and whatnot. But, you know, he's in the Soul Society. He's dead. Notice how all three of them that turned up with Ganju are dead. Tsukishima, Ginjo, Geriko. Yes, it was nice to see them again. Hopefully they have a prevalent role within the series, or within the arc, so to say. And again, hopefully Ganju does some work too, other than the sand monsters. If you know, you know. But yeah, it was nice to see Kukaku. Nice to hear her voice. Nice to see her smile. And it was a really good tease and a really good setup. And a nice update on her character design as well. That being said, if you like these reviews, please click and like the subscribe button. And of course, you know, hit me a comment in the comment section down below. Let me hear what you want to say about this episode and something that I may or may not have missed. Other than that, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day, JaymesHanson. And as always, people, peace out.